Today, I'd like to discuss another aspect of this bass removal program that Ben just covered. And I'd like to talk about changes in diets of two of the top predators in the lake in response to the long-term smallmouth bass removal. As I said, this is the same removal program that Ben just spoke about, and I'm going to present just data on Little Moose Lake, which is the one he focused on primarily. Again, it's in the Southwest Adirondack Park in upstate New York. It is a natural lake that is situated entirely on private property. It is, again, 271 hectares in area, maximum depth of 44 meters, and stratifies in the summer, which allows it to support both a warm, cold water fish community. Cold water species are there on the left, and lake trout are the dominant predator in that component. And there's seven warm water species, of which smallmouth bass is the dominant predator. We initiated this program. I'm not going to go into the details of the program much at all, since Ben already did. We initiated the program in spring of 2000 with the goal of recovering the native fish community and improving the salmonid fisheries. And the removal was accomplished through semi-annual littoral zone otoelectrofishing surveys, in which all the bass encountered were removed and all the other species were collected, enumerated, and measured and released back alive into the lake. And as Ben just got done saying, we did see significant recovery of the fish community. And so the objectives of the investigation I'm going to talk about today, or the objective, was to determine if and how diets of these two top predators, lake trout and smallmouth bass, changed in response to the community changes that occurred from the bass removal. So we were able to do this this comparison because we were fortunate enough to start gathering diet data prior to the bass removal. So we have data from 1996 through 2017, actually, but I'm only going to be presenting through 2016 because we haven't identified the diets from last year. Diets were obtained by either sacrificing fish and removing the entire stomach, or by gastric lavage. And for the purposes of this presentation, we're just going to limit the discussion to diets that were collected in the spring, April through June, to hopefully eliminate some seasonal differences we might have encountered, and also limiting it to adult fish, lake trout greater than 400 millimeters and smallmouth bass greater than 200 millimeters. And so what we wanted to do was compare the diets of these two predators before and after the removal. So we actually looked at three different periods. The pre-2001 is pre-removal. 2001 to 2007 is a post-removal period, but it corresponds to the time when rainbow smelt were present in the lake, but not in any appreciable numbers, according to our photoelectrofishing surveys. And then post-2007 is another post-removal period, but in this case, this is when smelt had become more of a major component of the fishing community. So for each diet, we identified every diet item to taxonomic level family, with the exception of things like copepods and ostracods and some terrestrial invertebrates. And then we took these data and calculated mean proportion by number of seven general prey groups for each of the predators for each of the three periods. And those categories were zooplankton, aquatic insects, fish, crayfish, other crustaceans, which were amphipods and isopods, terrestrial invertebrates, and other, which were anything that wasn't in those categories, and that included things like leeches and water mites and non-fish vertebrates. And we also calculated the mean proportion by number of each fish family within the fish prey group, because we're interested in seeing if the different components of the fish prey change with the relative abundance of fish community. And so because our data were not normally distributed or had equal variances or equal sample size, we used the Wells and Zenova on rank data to look for differences between the different periods, and then if the ANOVA showed significant differences to test on IK to determine which periods differ from one another. And significance was based on alpha 0.05. So moving on to the results, we have quite a few samples for both species in all three time periods, with a minimum of 122 samples per period for the lake trout and 233 for the smallmouth bass. And into the lake trout results first. Pre-removal, so pre-2001, lake trout diets, these are adult lake trout diets, were dominated by aquatic insects, which were primarily Hexagenia mayfly nymphs and Chironomic pupae, and then about 30% of the diets made up were made up of zooplankton. And fish represented just 1% by number of the prey consumed by adult lake trout prior to bass removal. Post-bass removal, the proportion of fish increased to 5% and then to 16%. And then post-2007, we also saw a large drop in the proportion of zooplankton in the diets. So if we look at the analysis of the rank data, we see that that drop in the zooplankton was significant post-2007. We also had a significant decline in aquatic insects after the removal began, and we had a significant and continued increase in the proportion of fish in the diets of lake trout after removal. Now, if we go in and look at the composition of those fish in the diet, we see that prior to removal, cotids or slimy sculpins made up 90% of the fish eaten by lake trout, and then salmonids made up the remaining 10%. Post-removal, it went from two families to four families represented in the fish prey of lake trout. We saw centrarchids, which were pumpkin seeds and smallmouth bass, come into the lake trout diets, and rainbow smelt as well, osmerids, showed up, and a large decline in the slimy sculpin contribution. Salmonids actually bumped up after the initial removal started, but then dropped post 2007. And again, if we look at the rank data analysis, we see that we had significant increases in Centrarchidae proportion and osmerids, the smell, and significant decline in the slimy sculpins over time with the removal. And the Salmonidae jumped around a little bit, but overall there was no significant difference between the pre-removal and the post-removal. And I should have said earlier, data with the same letter are not significantly different. So now looking at the same data for smallmouth bass, we see there's not nearly the substantial changes in proportions of different prey groups pre and post removal, but we do see a decline in the proportion of aquatic insects, an increase in the proportion of prey fish, and not really much of a change at all in the proportion of fish or the other lesser prey groups. And when we look at the rank data, we see that those were significant declines for the aquatic insects and a significant increase in the proportion of crayfish, and the proportion of fish did not really change at all. But if you look at the composition of the fish prey, you did see some differences. Pre-removal, again, they were primarily eating sculpins and some centrarchids and salmonids. So three families in the pre-removal diets. And post-removal, that increased to six different families. Still lots of slimy sculpins in the middle period there, but then a pretty sharp drop in them in the post-2007 period. That was coincident with a large increase in the appearance of rainbow smelt in the smallmouth bass diets post-2007. And we saw the centrarchids, looks like they declined a little bit, and the salmonids dropped some from pre to post. When we look at the rank data, we see the centrarchid changes weren't significant. There was a significant significant decline in the slimy sculpins post-2007 and a significant increase in the rainbow smelt post-2007, and as minor but significant decline in the Salmonidae over from previous breeds. So, in conclusion, we did see substantial changes in the diets of lake trout in response to the smallmouth bass removal. This was in the form of a decreasing proportion of invertebrates, of both insects and zooplankton in the diet, and increasing proportion of fish. And we did see a shift in the prey species, the fish prey species consumed over the course of the removal period, as the relative abundance of different prey species changed in response to the removal. The response for the smallmouth bass was more muted, but we did see significant declines in the proportion of aquatic insects and an increase in the proportion of prey fish. We did not see a change in the proportion of fish, but as for the lake trout, we did see a change in the proportions of the different prey fish families within the diet as their relative abundance in the fish community changed over time. The recovery has evidently shifted the predation pressure on the different prey species of fish to the detriment of some and to the benefit of others. It appears slimy sculpins now are consumed less frequently than they used to be in the past. And as Ben showed you in his presentation, that was one of the species that started off slowly, but eventually has showed this, this pretty nice increase over time. And then rainbow smelt, contrary to that, is actually looks like they're taking the brunt of the predation by lake trout and to a lesser degree smallmouth bass. And the removal of smallmouth bass also seems to have altered the predator-prey dynamics for the two top predators. Specifically, it looks, well, likely it's reduced intraspecific competition between lake trout and smallmouth bass, and also reduced intraspecific competition among smallmouth bass. This last conclusion is based, well, first we need to do more analysis of the actual caloric content of the prey, which we plan on doing, get a better idea as to how that's affecting growth. But these are lengthened age curves for both smallmouth bass adults, or smallmouth bass and lake trout. Ben showed you them, the one for the lake trout earlier. He had an intermediate period in there as well. But we can see that they both are growing faster and larger post-removal, and we suspect that this is a sign that shows that the bass removal program has resulted in a release from pretty intense competition for what were limited prey fish resources. So with that, I'd just like to acknowledge some of the many people that have contributed to this program over the years. Brian Weidel got it started, Jason Robinson, who did a lot of work collecting fish in the early years. Jesse Leepak did quite a bit of diet work, particularly on lake trout. Justin Shy was another person that helped with the electrofishing a lot, and then numerous graduate students, interns, and technicians over the years. And finally, I'd like to thank the Adirondack Lake Club for its financial support and allowing us to access the Loose Lake over all the years of the program.